Hello, good morning, everyone. It's one freaking year. I can't believe how much has changed. I don't know if you've seen the last video, but not the last video, but the very first video I ever made. And I mean, the only really difference is my jaw was a bit chunkier. But okay, let's get into it. Straight into it. I never have scripts, but bullet points of what I want to talk about. In this video, I just want to talk about what I've done in this past year. So let's start off with business, okay? It's been a roller coaster, right? Really high highs, really low lows. And like, I'm talking crazy high highs, crazy low lows. For example, on Friday, right, we hit our most profitable day. Not even our most profitable day, but it's like the most revenue we ever done in, I think, forever. It was $500, right? In 50% profit margins. And then when I look back, I don't know if this was ever recorded on YouTube, but when I launched TikTok ads for one of my first brands, Street Fashion, and they did bad, I was in a depressive state for like a whole week. I was like, should I really do drop shipping? Is it for me? Like, I was rethinking everything. It was not the best time. But the brand I've owned and made this year, I started off with Ringa Boxing Band. I think that was the first one. That's not the first brand I've ever started, but that's like the first one I've started from filming and doing these daily video journals. So Ringa Boxing Bands was an organic store that I made advertising like boxing bands, resistance bands to get better at boxing. I think they actually did work. I had them on me. I made content. I'll put a video on one of the content pieces I made up here.
Look at these beautiful flowers. You know what's more beautiful? This. So these are boxing resistance bands made to make your punches more faster and stronger after using them. And here's a quick video of me using it. You can see the form is absolutely immaculate, but you can also use it for other stuff like these quad exercises or these tricep exercises right here. And it's also dog approved, so you should really buy one. And yeah, bye.
It was really just like motivational videos. And after earning a boxing band, I transitioned into Lumos Lamp. And I think this is when I bought my first course ever. Ringer Boxing Bands did horrible, not one sale. But Lumos Lamb, also horrible, not one sale. I'll put a piece of content up as well.
After years of prototyping, we finally made the best and most aesthetic. Our lamp has three levels of brightness, and it's portable, so I can take it everywhere.
And the Lumos Lamb, I actually have it right here with me. Love this product, great product, but yet again, not a single sale. But this did further my knowledge in dropshipping, because it was because of this I bought a course in organic dropshipping by The Collective with Jimmy and Cal, I think that's their name. By the way, great server, number, like, it was amazing. It's like $10 a week, and I had it for like 4 weeks or so. So yeah, that a great server. I learned a lot from that, and that was amazing. So after boxing bands, I think I decided to do Google Ads, which is organic to Google. Is quite the interesting switch. So I started with Google. I don't really remember the first ones. I think the first product I ran was fanny packs. No. What am I talking about? I ran Lumos Lamps on Google Ads as well, I believe. And then I also got no sales. I made a fanny pack store. I don't know if I actually have a photo of that, but that was like a really good looking website. Google Ads, no sales. Right about now, we're about $200, $300 down, but no profit, maybe more. And then I run a hoodie blanket, the hoodie blanket, practically copying the hoodie. No sales as well. So now we're probably like $400 through $50 down. And then I decide to run jewelry on Google Ads. I believe it was jewelry that I was running. I don't really remember because I was testing a bunch of just like generic products on Google. But I think it was jewelry. If not, you can watch through all my videos and double check. But I did jewelry and under the domain name Makai Pursuit. So that, not a sale, not a single sale. It was pretty bad. But it was jewelry that really bridged me into the other things. I'll get on that later. But with jewelry, Google Ads didn't do so well. I think I did like the ABC necklace, or like a leather necklace people would buy and like customize. That necklace, you probably see me wear in some of the older videos. And then I actually did that on Snapchat ads, and that did actually got sales. I still wasn't profitable at this point. In fact, I was still like really down. Like this set that or test that I did was did not get any sales. Or no, it did get sales, just wasn't profitable. So I did Snapchat ads on that, and then I started noticing results with Snapchat ads, even though that wasn't profitable. So I started testing a lot of stuff on Snapchat ads. So I test a bunch of different types of jewelry, and probably some other products. I tested a hair curler. It might have been Snapchat and Google, but I tested quite a few products. And then I tested this rainbow window film, Regnbåge Fönsterfilm, because I was targeting Sweden. So I built my whole website in Swedish, which actually took me like 3 days. And then turns out you could have like a Shopify app or like another one of those things just like automatically translate everything. So that sucked a lot. But anyway, so I do Snapchat ads for that. It doesn't perform too well. In fact, I think that was probably like my worst test, because all my tests on Snapchat have been break even. And then when I test that, I don't think it was profitable. I might have tested another piece of jewelry later. And then I see this jewelry and I want to run it up on Facebook, right? Because keep in mind, I'm switching platforms like left and right. Before I started doing video diaries, I had street fashion, right? But then I went to Blenado. And then after Blenado, which was like a juicer with TikTok Organic, I went to, and I'll put a video up on the screen on one of those.
I just got the Blenado. It has made my life so much more easier. It makes smoothies instantly and blends so fast. Now I can make smoothies anytime, anywhere.
I went to Google Ads. I don't remember what I was running. And I went back to Organic. And then Google, and then Snapchat, and now Facebook. So Facebook, I ran a jewelry to get me started, a jewelry product. I didn't do too well. And then I was studying Iman Godsey's course. I got that ripped, of course. I'm not gonna buy it. But I got that and I was studying it. And then I ran some shapewear that was, or no, I was also running shapewear on Snapchat ads. I actually ran a lot of shapewear on Snapchat ads. I think I ran like 6 pieces of shapewear on Snapchat ads. All of them were relatively profitable. All of them were break-even. And I might have ran some shapewear on Facebook. I remember I was driving up to I don't know if I have a video of it, but I was driving to my friend's birthday and I see Skims, massive wallpaper. I'm getting a car. I'm gonna quickly mute that. I saw Skims massive wallpaper on the mall and I was like, I'm gonna have my brand there. It did not go there. In fact, the ads were unprofitable to break even on Facebook and Snapchat. I might have ran on Facebook, I'm not too sure. But that kind of bridged me into Facebook. So after I did some stuff with Facebook, I don't really remember what I was doing at the time. But then I look at this Discord server and I see this person in Opportunities. It's like this channel called Opportunities in my friend's Discord server. And I check this guy called Francis is hiring interns for... hiring interns. So one of the interns was ad making, the other one, or media buying, the other one was copywriting, the other one was website design. So I sent out an application. At first I was like, do I really want to do this? I was like off the edge, but then I thought something good might happen from this. So I just decided to do it, which is good because I don't know where I would have been if I didn't do it. I think about that sometimes. But I do that. I send him application. I ask if I can be media buyer or website designer. I was really hoping for website designer, but I got media buyer, which is great. And I'm so glad I did, because I love making ads. Bro, why do I keep getting messages? I swear I have notifications off. I don't know if you guys are hearing that or not. But anyways, so I do that. And this was when I was in Palm Springs, or I think it was Palm Springs. I got on the call with a guy, not an interview, just asked me a bit about myself. And I think the only reason why I got the job is because I sent him a snap, a spreadsheet with every single ad I ran on Snapchat. And it was a massive spreadsheet. It was like 60 something ads. And I recorded all the CPMs and metrics and all that stuff. So that might have persuaded him. So I got working with him. So I was making his Facebook ad. And I learned a lot about Facebook ads with this guy. So I probably do that for quite a few months. And then eventually the other people, the copywriter and the website designer, people who got those roles, we make a group chat, or the website designer made a group chat and then asked us if he wants to if they want to start a business, or if we want to start a business with him and kind of just like test like how the guy we're working for is doing. So I was like, okay, bet, let's do it. And so I did the copywriter, he also said that. So a few days later, we're looking for products, we're trying to like figure out some of this stuff. And we're starting, this is probably a few months before I leave to Sweden. It's getting a bit recent now. We talk for a bit, we set up a lot, we set up the Shopify store, we look at the sleep niche. Turns out that wasn't the best niche to do. So we go away from that one, and then we, because we couldn't find any products, and then we go to the active niche, like active supply, active and health and such. And that's a pretty broad name. So we bought the domain. We actually bought a domain for the sleep one, never ended up using it. But we bought the domain for the active one, active and health. And so from that point, we're getting like the products up and ready, and I've made some ads. So we launched the ads, I don't remember exactly what day, but we launched the ads, $50 ABO, CBO, or no, ABO, just normal ads, 3 to 5 ads. I asked the guys interning for any like advice. He gave me some advice and we launched it. So we launched the ads, first day, $50, unprofitable. It was unprofitable. Second day, unprofitable, or break even. Third day, break even or unprofitable. Fourth day, or this might have been fourth or third, like I forget, I don't really remember, but the copywriter leaves because he's doing another internship, and he says he doesn't have time for the Francis internship, the store, and the other internships, which is funny because I was doing 3 internships as well. But which was a portal learning internship, I might cover that later. But anyways, he leaves. Literally the next day he leaves, we do like $200. We have like our biggest day. And then from there, we didn't increase the budget straight off the bat. Or maybe we did. We did increase the budget. And then it starts performing at like a break-even ROAS, a return on ad spend. And it's nothing like too crazy. I don't even think we were profitable at that point yet, but we run it up a bit. We get a DSO, so $50 daily spend limit, and we can't spend any more than $50, and that persists until a few days until I leave for Sweden. The DSO goes away without us knowing. It spends $50 in the day, and then at night it spends like another $50. But we only look at the metrics during the day. And then I'm on the plane to Sweden. And I think actually before I go on the plane, or a week before or so, we get the DSO removed and it spends pretty high. And then we get another DSO. I might just be making stuff up. But anyway, so we go on the plane and I thought we still had a DSO. So I put my plane on airplane mode as I'm traveling to Spain. I turn it off and then cha-ching, cha-ching, cha-ching. It's like 7, 9 notifications from Shopify. sale notifications. And it turns out the DSO, you guys already know this because I told you, but the DSO wasn't there. Spent like $120 and like a 2 or 3 ROAS, which is pretty good. But the day prior, I spent like $128. That was known. I thought I only spent 50 and only got like one sale. So from it doing like a 0.2 ROAS to like a 3 or 4 ROAS is pretty crazy. It's like 10x. But then it continues like that for like 2 days, and then another DSL, and then I'll have a DSL all through Spain, I believe, and all through Sweden until the end of Sweden. I'm in Spain for 2 weeks, and then I go to Sweden for a month. Until the end of Sweden, we get the DSL removed, and it is like a 3 or 4 ROAS. What am I talking about? It's like a 2 ROAS, maybe 3. I'm tired of talking. I've talked this whole time. I've just got back from babysitting. But the ROAS is still break even to profitable, some unprofitable days. During that whole 6 weeks when I was traveling, we had the ads up running at $50. And some days we'd get 3 sales, some days we'd get 1 sale, some days we'd get 0 sales. On average, we were break even though. So I'm surprised. Like, ran a product, we've been running this product for maybe 3 months now, and it's pretty crazy to think about. Because I don't know if I mentioned this, but the start at the beginning was such a long process because the ordering the products took a long time, and there was a bunch of other issues that you could just look at my YouTube videos and you'll see. But anyway, so that happened, and let's see. So the ads are performing okay. The DSL gets removed and performs pretty good. And then I leave Sweden. DSL stays up for a bit. Actually, we're increasing the budget now because it's profitable. And then it crashes. So hold up, give me a second. Bye. My brother ran into the kitchen naked. So where was I? DSL gets removed, we're running the ads up, and we are increasing the budget, so maybe it's like $100, $150 now, and it's break even, maybe a few profitable days, a few unprofitable, but like relatively break even, and then it starts doing a bit good, and this is when I'm back from Sweden, then everything just crashes. We get another DSL, and then our manufacturer is not responding, or a supplier saying the manufacturer's not sending out products, or like something happened in the manufacturing thing and can't send out products. And then we're starting to get a bunch of refunds. So all this stuff just happens in 1 week. And I actually made a video about it. I'll put it up, show it somewhere here. And that was like such a crazy moment. That's such a stressful moment. And yeah, that was crazy. So after that, we recuperate. The ads are no longer profitable, so we kill them. And then we launch a bunch of other ads. They're unprofitable. During that period to about now, or a few weeks from now, or a few weeks ago, we're just launching a bunch of ads and they're unprofitable. And we're really thinking, like, I think we should give up until we find this video and the strategy for testing, and it is a running an ad set or running your campaign, ABO and DCT's dynamic creative testing, and a bunch of like 2 headlines and 2 paragraphs, or 2 primary, 2 headers, and like 3 videos in the DCT, and all of them were TOFs, the top funnel. So we run that, and that does horrible. And now we're really thinking, I think we should just like stop it. I think we should end it, move on to the next product. And it's just me and the website designer, me and Justin. So I look and I analyze our data because I'm really lost. I call my friend, agency friend, and he's like, why don't you just use some of your clips from your order videos? Because one of our clips had like a 60% thumbs up rate and all of our ones now have like 20%. And I was like, I didn't think about that. So I make a massive spreadsheet similar to the Snapchat one, and I sort everything in there. I put all the ad performances on Facebook that I ran for Active Supply, and really just analyze that. And I see that some of our ads were profitable and like doing pretty good. So I take all the ads that were profitable, and I'll make a Frankenstein ad. And the Frankenstein ad is basically just a bunch of clips that had good metrics. So for example, the clip with the highest thumb stop rate combined with the one with the highest video hold rate combined with the one with that had the highest CTR. And for the CTR, we just took like the end of a video and we put that on the actual Frankenstein ad. So we put all, so in total, it's like four creatives. Three of them were relatively profitable. So one picture ad, three video ads. One of the video ads was the Frankenstein ad. We launched that. And we launched that on a Thursday. We launched it for Thursday. We launched it on Wednesday. For Thursday, I believe. First day is it's break even. Friday is 5 ROAS. And that was a week ago. So that was a 5 ROAS. Saturday and Sunday was break even. Monday, Tuesday was 0.83 ROAS. Tuesday, Wednesday was a, what was it? It was a 2-3 ROAS. And then Friday again, it was a 5 ROAS. And on that Friday, we increased the budget to $100. So we made $500. That was our highest spend. And on our videos, maybe I'll put it somewhere here. We had like the most profitable days ever. It was like overall it was profitable, but as in this was like the most amount we probably have made. And also I put a bunch of hypothesis on why it's like 0.83 ROAS one day, 0.5 or 5% ROAS another day. Not 5%, but 5 ROAS another day. And it was crazy. So right now we're still in learning phase on the ads, about 40 or so conversions, 40 or 39 conversions right now out of 50. So we just need another 11 more. So I reckon we'll have that by Wednesday or Monday or Tuesday. And maybe we put the spend at $500 on Friday again. If we get another 5 ROAS, that's $2,500 in profit, or $2,500 in revenue, $1,750 in profit if we continue our 50% profit margins as we normally see during Fridays. So that is really interesting. And that's kind of the business journey. 21 minutes for the business journey. I have so much more to talk about. And this product we're selling is an EMS foot massager, by the way. So some of the key things I've learned throughout this year, since October 15th, 2022, is that creatives are key. I'm back. Creatives are key, right? Number one. Know who you're targeting, like your target audience and your target market, and target market sophistication level, and as well as DSLs are a bitch. I hate DSLs, and I don't think anyone does like them, because they're so annoying. So those are some of the few things. There are so many things I've learned throughout this. It's like so many intricate and specific things. It'd be hard and unfair to condense it all into like a few sentences. So if there's like any questions, questions like my friends ask me, if I'm running an ABO and this metric has X thing and yada yada yada, what should I do? Like, I could provide more like advanced feedback, or it's like more specific feedback. Most of the stuff you learn dropshipping is pretty specific. It's not many like overarching. I'm sure there are a bunch of overarching things that you should know, but that's like pretty general and it could be applied to everything. And I've been doing a lot of things to make money because I think overall this whole period I am unprofitable. Makai Pursuit made about $700 or so, maybe $800, with Snapchat and Google. But then you also have to remember I've probably spent the same amount on Snapchat and Google. So now with break even, this is starting to become profitable. It's still break even, probably down like a few hundred dollars each of us. But I've been doing like babysitting, a lot of babysitting, actually just got back from babysitting, already told you guys that, cleaning roofs and clearing out garages. So yeah, lots of stuff. But go on to the next section. Self-improvement. All right, so self-improvement, so much stuff. Crazy amount of stuff. So going to the gym, obviously, that's like a pillar in self-improvement. So I started going to the gym about this time last year, and I was relatively lean, skinny, not like too crazy skinny, but I saw I had abs to an extent. I remember 2 years ago I had a little bit of a stomach, nothing too crazy, and during quarantine I did 30 pull-ups or so every single day. I don't think I recorded that, but I don't think I had this channel by then at that time, but I did 30 pull-ups every day, so that's why I had like pretty big biceps in the back start of high school, but like my chest wasn't anything crazy. So I start going to the gym. My friend Cade actually comes down here, and I hit like my first gym session with him at the YMCA, because prior to that I was just doing HIIT classes with my mom and a trainer, and that's not going to get me like a pillow chest. So I start going to the gym. I noticed that I'm pretty lean or cut. I posted a video of myself flexing. I don't remember exactly what day it was. Someone said, awesome, you should go on a bulk. That might have been on the Discord channel, but I remember the exact video and I was like, all right, bet, bulk time, baby. So I go on a bulk, I put a video up here, me on my bulk. And bulk is, I was 120 or 130 when I started, and I bulked all the way to 150. And right now I'm 140 right now. So I go on the cut after the bulk, cut for the summer, so I make sure I'm all ripped for Spain and Sweden. I'm probably the leanest right now in my life. After I cut, I kind of maintain the cut for a bit until now. I'm probably going to go back on the bulk for November to January. That's the plan. I've gotten like pretty big. Like, here's a comparison of me starting to do pull-ups and me pull-ups not too long ago. It's pretty crazy. Another thing that has improved is diet. My diet was anything crazy. I probably ate like ice cream every now and then so often. I'd eat candy whenever I got my hands on it. Chocolate, chips. Junk food, and that wasn't that good. And so I improved a lot of my diet because I started reading a lot about like what diet really does to your health and just health in general. So a lot of stuff happened. So when I turned 17, I cut out all added sugars and all trans fats from my diet. And I wanted to say something. I don't think I put this on channel yet. But I had this bread, and I look at the ingredients a few days later, I notice it has added sugars. So what do you guys think? Does that count as me like resetting it? Because I didn't know. I thought it was just normal bread. No added sugars. It didn't taste sweet. It was just normal bread. But that kind of threw me off. And same thing for today, for gaming. I don't play games. Another thing for when I turned 17, a pillow that I had was no playing games. But I had to play games with the babysitting people I was babysitting. The parent literally told me, play games with the children for a bit. I don't think she really said it like that, but like she was, that was on the agenda. And I was like, I don't know. I was thinking about it a lot, but I did end up doing it. So let me know if you think that is a reset or a fail. I haven't played games since then. Speaking of, I have, during this whole thing, started street fashion long, long time ago. I was playing games every day, and it was really until like January when I stopped really playing games so much. No, it was actually like this time last year. I stopped playing games so much. I started cooling down. I started playing games like maybe once a week, a few times a week, and then like once a month, and then like very often, not often. And it was, I mean, I don't get me wrong, I love playing games. I have a great amount of, or great, good people I used to play games with, but not anymore. Or they didn't die, I just don't play games anymore. So that was the games, and diet improved a lot. I now eat, off topic, but I eat like 5-4 eggs a day, and I think that's just amazing. And the reason why is because eggs have a lot of minerals, and minerals and vitamins and micronutrients, all that fun stuff is so, I've learned so much stuff about biochemistry and nutritional biochemistry, which every day, and speaking of every day, I've been writing about something regarding to biochemistry in a little journal I have. I'm on entry 115 right now. And if you ever look at my journal, you would find, like, one day I'm talking about lycopene, another day I'm talking about polyaromatic hydrocarbons, one day I'm talking about aspartame, and then another day I'm talking about like the gut microbiome. So it's pretty versatile in that manner, and I've just learned so much about biochemistry. Actually, I put a video up. I gave a TED talk about glucose to my school for the talent show.
I'm gonna be talking about glucose, how to live longer and look better. But before I start, I'll show you guys this piece of candy. Okay. Right. This goody pop blue color, right? It might seem like an innocent piece of candy that you might eat from a friend or a teacher. This piece of candy has a lot of devastating effects that can happen and such. Okay, I won't say a lot, but like a lot of bad stuff can happen, okay? And I'm gonna dive into that in this presentation. So, next slide, please. So this is my friend Jeremy. I've known him for about 13 years or so, and we met when we were about 3. So when he was about 6 or 5 years old, he was a pretty lean individual, okay? But then throughout the ages from that point, he started packing on weight, all right? I started to see him eat a lot more candy and lots more food with starches like pasta or white bread. And then eventually, one day, we were trick-or-treating with Halloween, right? I think it was about 12 then, or 10 o'clock. And we had these super adorable costumes. I had a train Thomas the Tank Engine costume. He had the red one. I forgot his name. But we were going door to door. So for every piece of candy that Johnny got, he ate, right? And you can kind of, that's pretty fast, okay? Because we were pretty cute kids and we had really adorable costumes, so they're probably gonna give us a lot more candy, okay? So that's a lot of sugar being eaten. So about 3/4 of the way there, we knock at this person's house, all right? It opens. Hello, children. How can I help you? Do you guys want candy? We say, yes, of course we want candy. So he gives us the candy, all right? And as we're walking away, Johnny freezes, okay? He kneels over, and then he falls to the ground, all right? He stops moving. So then his family has to take him to a hospital. I didn't know what was going on, but it turns out that Johnny was in the hospital for 3 days and died of cardiac arrest. It's not funny. But I'm gonna get into that. This story is fortunately not true, but this is how a lot of Americans, what happens to a lot of Americans. 3 in 5 deaths are from inflammation, and glucose is one of the causes of that. So how does glucose work? Next slide, please. So let's say I wake up one day and I'm gonna eat some pancakes. I haven't eaten for about 8 or so hours or 10 hours, right? Because I fell asleep. So let's say I eat about 28 grams of pancakes. I'm not eating for 10 hours. The glucose from the pancakes, and glucose, if you don't already know, is starches and sugars, will go straight into my digestive system the mitochondria, right, the powerhouse of the cell, will turn it into energy, ATP. And that's why glucose is super important, all right? ATP is your body's favorite energy source, and it's the energy source the body uses the most, okay? But the mitochondria will get overloaded if there's too much sugar and too much starches in the body. So what happens is the body will introduce insulin to regulate its process. So the insulin will actually store the glucose in the liver and the muscles. But then when those are full, it will store it in the fat molecules. And that's why when you eat a lot of candy, a lot of starches, then you start to gain fat. This process is called lipogenesis. Next slide. So what are the dangers of glucose? Okay, we talked about this, a benefit. The energy is a benefit. If you eat too much, then a lot of bad things can happen. All right, so start off with the physical. Okay, obviously you gain weight. All right, this can lead to obesity and diabetes, two and three. Diabetes two is eating too much, and diabetes three is now classified as Alzheimer's. All right, and you actually
Happy I wasn't too. It was really, it all really all started from a podcast interview on Diarrhea CVO with the glucose goddess. And then that led me to do a TED talk for my talent show, which I won, I think. The other contenders weren't anything crazy. One person was singing last Friday night with a group of girls, actually, which wasn't good. It wasn't that good. And I actually got bombed. Because one of my friends got up from the stage, and it wasn't really a stage, it was just a bunch of chairs, and just started like doing this Roblox dance right in front of the whole audience. Such a crazy story. So that was one contender, and then the other contender, only three people included, or three teams, the other people were playing Clash Royale. I'm not kidding you, they're dead ass playing Clash Royale in front of the class. They had it screen shared, and they were doing, I think they were doing duos against some other people. It wasn't it. And then I go in talking about glucose and insulin, and my presentation was a little wrong because I framed insulin as the bad guy. We need insulin. If we don't have insulin, then I think we're diabetic, so we need insulin. And I kind of framed it as a bad guy, but the general point was don't eat too much sugar, and if you do eat sugar, there's some things you can do to avoid the glucose spike. And I talked about all the benefits and all the negatives and yada yada yada, and all that fun stuff. So after watching that, getting back on track here, but after watching that podcast with Diarrhea CVO and the glucose goddess, that really led me down the path of biochemistry. And yeah, I mean, I read an NCBI article every single day now. I still do. I just kind of scan past the article until I see the conclusion. And I also look at the methodology, of course. I'm not going to draw any crazy conclusions from a petri dish study or epidemiological study or a rat study or anything like that. And I also look at the conflict of interest, see if it's funded like by any of the corporations. Like if there was a study on aspartame, saying that it's good and it's healthy and actually eating it is going to lower your cholesterol levels. And then I scroll down to the method and it says it's like some horribly tested things. Like they took a bunch of rats who have cancer and then gave the ones who had cancer like aspartame, and there's no effects, and it's like a bunch of other stuff, and just like pee-bombed it. I think that was my friend said, like, pee-bombed it, I think, or something. I don't really remember what he said, but it's like messing it up. That's not a real study, I think. But then like scrolling further down to the conflict of interest to see this was funded by Coca-Cola, and then you already know, okay, this can't be trusted. So lots of NCBI articles and lots of fun stuff. I mostly read the abstract, methodology, conflict of interest, and the conclusion. And sometimes I'll glance at the other stuff. So, yeah. And another thing, kind of going back to going to the gym, I've gained a lot more confidence. And you'll probably see it in the videos. At the beginning, I was a bit more shy. Now I'm literally filming a video out on my kitchen. And just like overconfidence, I've gained so much. That's super important. And kind of similar to confidence, fighting. I've gotten pretty damn good at fighting. Not like crazy yet, not like Johnny Jones or Israel Adesanya, but I'm like okay, like I can last. I'm red belt in Taekwondo right now. When I started, I was green belt at the time. Oh, oops, my lamp fell. Little more same. At the time of like I think last year or so, or I think at the start of January or maybe this time of October, I started Taekwondo again because I stopped during quarantine. I broke my arm and everything, whole thing. But I start up again and I start from green belt. Now I'm red belt. So it was green belt, green stripe, blue belt, blue stripe, I think. Yeah, red belt. So about five belts later. Then no, I must have started like 2 years ago. Because like we get like two belts a year or something like that, or maybe three belts a year. Anyways, not that important. We start sparring this year. That's the important part. Because now that we're doing sparring, we do sparring like almost every Wednesday now. Sparring is just, it's godsend. I mean, I just love sparring so much. It's fighting is so fun. I'm not like a masochist. I don't like love getting punched in the face, but I mean, I kind of do. And not in a weird way. It's just that fury, not fury, but that power. It just feels so good. So I've gotten a lot into sparring. I put one of the videos of me fighting with my boys. They had to sleep over here and we're doing boxing. And I'll also put up some sparring videos that I had. I don't really film myself sparring so much because I don't think we can film ourselves during class. It'd be a bit rude if we're doing class and then I just prop up a camera. And I don't know about the other person if they want to be on camera or not. My battery is actually running out, so I'm going to have to speed this up. It's almost 40 minutes, which is pretty bonkers. I don't know if I'm going to edit this if it's 40 minutes. We'll see. I don't know if CapCut will be able to handle that. Anyways, so we do some sparring. Sparring is great. And yeah, I just fell in love with it. I've been doing some BJJ. Actually, I don't think I'm going to edit this. I think I might just put some of the links of the videos I refer to in the comments or in the wherever, somewhere. And the creators, I'll find a way. But yeah, so I do a lot of BJ. I started to do a lot of BJJ with my friends. Some friends are actually coming over for a sleepover again 2 weeks from now. Around this time, we have like our first big sleepover, which is going to be so fun. It's going to be like 12 people or so. I'm going to do lots of working out, maybe some basketball, sparring, of course, obviously. But most likely boxing, BJJ. I doubt we're going to do like MMA or Taekwondo because it's a pretty small space. Unless we do it outside, but we'll see. And yeah, so that's fighting. Fighting and business is like the main things I think about nowadays. And yeah, I feel like I've also become one with nature. I started to go on more walks. It was a period when I went on a walk every day with my dog. Another way I started to make money, my mom would pay me $5 if I took the dogs out for a 40-minute walk every day. So I would do that, and it's just really peaceful. And speaking of peaceful, I've started meditating a lot. So I probably have like 10,000 minutes plus on meditation. And yeah, that's self-improvement part. Probably a bunch more that I'm missing out on talking about, but that's like the general gist of it. And to end it off, some of the cool things I've done in this past year is going to Spain and Sweden. That's amazing. I traveled to Spain by myself. Actually got lost. I got lost in the middle of the night. I'll put the video somewhere here. And yeah, it was like 2 o'clock at night. I got lost, Google Maps wasn't working, my phone was about to die in the middle of Spain. Yeah, that was pretty crazy. I was confident that I'd return, but I was thinking about sleeping on the sidewalk, actually. But I also won an NHD thing, a state competition. No, nationals. No, what am I talking about? county. I won county. We traveled to San Francisco for state. Did not win state, unfortunately. Kind of pisses me off. But it was good. It was all good fun. I had a fun time with my guys there. And yeah, a few internships. The one I was talking about. The majority of this video is talking about business, I think. But that one internship where I was making ads, I did another internship with Portal Learning, my school. And the task is a bit unclear of what I was doing, I'm not gonna lie. I worked with this AI called Known, and I kind of just made it, like, kind of just promoted it. I wrote a research brief about it, me and my partner, and some other stuff. And yeah, lots of stuff. I've gotten better at soccer, basketball, fighting, of course, taekwondo, BJJ. I've gotten better. I'm just overall so much better, a lot leaner, and yeah. It's been quite a journey. One fucking year is crazy. Pretty crazy to think about, actually. But I'm gonna end this one off here. I think this is actually the longest video on my entire channel, which is, well, I started just recently, like, making longer videos. But yeah, okay. 40 so minutes. I'm gonna end it off here. Love you guys. If you're anyone's watching up to here, leave a comment or something. I really care about the YouTube algorithm. If I'm gonna edit this, I want to have some results. We'll see. It's 40 minutes. I don't know if anyone wants to watch all of that. But okay, I'm gonna end it off here. I'll see you guys tomorrow. And yeah, 1 year, baby.